meters and it's going to be all in one room. And so I really, yeah, just want to take a moment to thank you. And I'm mentioning it here because along with individual emergency preparedness, you agree with me that seeing your building in the community prepared is equally as important. So before we get started with that, I want to take a moment to thank Vial Fotheringham for donating their time tonight to address our questions and to present information that will be helpful to us in this planning process. And I also want to thank Hoy Realty Group. They've allowed us to use this space, and I also want to recognize City Bible Church for the comfy seats, the sound system, and all the amenities that we need to make this event happen. Lastly, I want to thank the PDNA Liability Committee, Jan Valentine, and everybody else here that just worked tirelessly to improve our neighborhood and make it the best neighborhood in the entire world, my humble opinion. So I think right now would be a good time to mention we do have a neighborhood emergency team. And I'm not sure if everyone is familiar with the neighborhood emergency team, but we do have our captain here tonight, Gary Tamano. If you might stand up, Gary. Gary's going to be at the back of the room after the presentation. If you are interested in joining this effort, it's a great way to get involved. Not necessarily on a building level, but on a community level. So there are many, many areas that you can help. So please talk to Gary after the event. He'll be at the back of the room. Oh, I also want to introduce our other, if you wouldn't mind, the other neighborhood emergency team members, would you mind raising your hand? Excellent. All right. So just real quick, these folks have been through training and work along with PDM to become prepared to help all of us on an individual level. So there's a number of great things you can do just to step in there. Tonight, we're going to focus on the buildings we live, work, and play in, and getting them prepared. Each person here can contribute some piece to that building's preparedness. And we hope that you'll leave tonight motivated and willing to take action. Because we can talk about it, we can, you know, read about it, but unless we take action and actually start taking steps, setting deadlines, and making a plan come together, it's not going to happen. That said, there are 19 buildings in this neighborhood that have really taken some great strides in the planning process. There are some sample plans at the back of the room. On the other side of the table, there are also some individual pieces for information. And these different buildings include, apartment buildings, condominiums, and the like. So I want to thank those folks that are in the room tonight that have already taken those great steps. So we've been focusing on individual preparedness in this series of roundtable discussions, and we're going to pause on individual preparedness to bring in Kevin Harker. Kevin practices with Vial Fotheringham out of their Portland office. And he focuses on homeowner association and condominium association law, litigation, and landlord-tenant issues. When you came in, well, you'll see there's cards on the seats around you. During his presentation, if you could write your questions, we will go through those questions one by one at the end of this end of the presentation. It'd probably be the easiest way to make sure as many people's questions are answered as possible. So that said, I'm going to go ahead and just really quickly before we have Kevin get started, point out we are doing a neighborhood-wide fundraiser. Ready, Set, Go Kids has agreed to contribute 10% of the sale of emergency kits. And keep in mind, I know many of us probably have backpacks or emergency kits maybe in our home. But also consider having emergency kits at your office, in your car, and also be a great gift. So any of the proceeds, the 10% of the proceeds go to support the Pro-District Neighborhood Association's emergency preparedness efforts. And you do have to enter a code, and Clayton at the back of the room, he has the Ready, Set, Go kit, so take a moment to grab those. He's holding them up right now on your way out. And if you go online, make the purchase and enter the NWNW code after, that'd be great. That'll help bring the funds in our direction. So that's it. I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to Kevin and join me in welcoming.
Just out of curiosity, how many are condo owners? What about apartment dwellers? Okay, and managers, at least one, several. So a partner in my firm several years ago told me he does estate planning and wills and trusts, and when he first started, he was always shocked that people my age, Kurt, how are you? People my age with kids weren't anxious to get wills and trusts put together. But what he realized is people don't like to think about dying, and that's what you have to think about. And the same thing is true with emergency preparedness and disaster recovery. It's people don't like to think about what's going to happen when something affects their building, earthquake, flood, fire. Hopefully, though, this will strike a fire under you, no pun intended, to get something in place, some kind of plan in place, so that when things do happen, you know exactly what to do. In other words, it becomes habit or routine. I have done some volunteer work for the Portland Mountain Rescue and been to a lot of the Red Cross training, and that scared the bejesus out of me. And for several years, I've carried an emergency kit in my car. I have a 72-hour kit in my house. And I have sort of a plan in place in my own mind about what to do should something happen. Most people don't, though. They've never thought about it. So my goal tonight is to at least get you to start thinking about it. If you're on a board, and we'll talk about how to go about that in a minute, but it is a board, whether or not you have an obligation to put some kind of plan together so that when something does happen, owners know what to do. I'm going to try to control this slideshow. Hopefully it'll work. Okay, so in terms of the differences, and there's more condo owners than apartment renters, but in terms of the difference between those two, keep in mind a condominium isn't an architectural style, it's a form of ownership. If you drove by a structure, whether it's a high rise or a townhome, you have no idea if it's a condominium without looking at their legal documents. So all a condominium means is that each individual owns the unit, which is typically the finished surface in, and then they have a joint ownership interest in the limited and common elements, the general common elements. So if there's 100 units, I would own 1/100th of the roof, the siding, the parking structure. Whereas in an apartment complex, it's a single owner, could be an individual or a corporation or several owners, who own all parts of the property and give the right to live there to individual renters. And there's different legal obligations imposed by the law between condo boards and landlords, and I'll talk about those in a minute. In the condominium setting though, almost always, in Oregon, always, because it's the law, there has to be a board of directors established that run the affairs and operations of the condo. They're elected by the owners, and they have what are called fiduciary relationships. So ordinarily in the law, I owe certain duties to my fellow citizens. For example, not to run them over, not to trip them. Those are regular legal duties that are imposed on me. But if I have a fiduciary duty, that's above and beyond those regular duties. That means every decision I make, everything I do, has to be done for the best interest of the person that I owe that fiduciary duty to. So if you're on the board, every decision you make as a board member has to be done with the mindset of, is this in the best interest of all of the owners? So fiduciaries, for example, your accountant owes you a fiduciary duty, your lawyer owes you a fiduciary duty, and you as a board owe fiduciary duties to the owner. So there's this higher burden of duties owed to another that is imposed by the law. For the landlord, though, it's a little different. They don't have a fiduciary duty, but they do have a duty to make sure that the premises are habitable, that it's safe, that it complies with federal law, for example, the Americans with Disability Act or the Fair Housing Act. So there are sort of these extra legal duties, but they don't rise to the level of the fiduciary duties. Liability. So I often have clients ask me, well, am I going to get sued for this, or am I going to get sued for that? My answer is always, maybe, Anyone can sue anyone for anything. It's easy. You can file a lawsuit today. You walk down to the courthouse, pay $150, and you can sue someone. Whether or not it has merit is a whole other story. It's the defense costs that often run up. Lawyers charge a lot of money, and you may end up having defense costs that are more than whatever the claim is. But in terms of who can get sued in a condominium context, the board as a whole, and there are still some unincorporated condo boards. In the late 90s, the Condo Act was amended to say that all condo associations must be incorporated, but some of those pre-1998 condo boards are unincorporated, so there is no association to sue, so they sue the board of directors. Individual board members can be sued. The corporation, assuming it's incorporated in an organ, it's going to be a nonprofit corporation, and sometimes the management company. And depending on who the lawyer is for the plaintiff or the owner, they may sue all of these folks. Now, most of your governing documents, and when I say governing documents, I'm referring to CCNRs, bylaws, articles of incorporation, almost all of them have an indemnification provision, which says, if I'm on the board and I get sued, if I, Kevin Harker, get sued, the association has to indemnify me. So in other words, the association has to pay for a lawyer to defend me. If there's a verdict against me, they have to pay that, as long as I'm not grossly negligent. And grossly negligent just means I made a decision that I knew beforehand was going to harm someone. But if you make a bad decision, and you did your homework, and you asked experts about it, and it still turned out to be a bad decision, there's generally not going to be liability on your behalf as an individual board member. Management companies often get sued. Most management contracts still have an indemnification provision as well, which says, if I, management company, get sued, you, association, have to pay my legal fees. You have to pay a judgment if it gets in against me, usually if it's gross negligence or willful misconduct, though. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because one of the questions that I've been asked frequently is, well, do we have to have an emergency preparedness plan? And that's a very tricky question. And the reason for that is, well, would you get sued if you didn't have one in place and an earthquake occurred tomorrow and people got injured? Perhaps. I doubt it, but perhaps. You could certainly get sued. Would you be liable, legally liable? And I think the answer to that is probably not. I did a case law research for all the jurisdictions and couldn't find anything definitive about whether or not there's a duty for a board to have an emergency preparedness plan in place. But if you're a fiduciary and you owe those owners that fiduciary duty, there's a good chance that maybe you do have a duty to make sure that if there is a disaster, you've informed the owners of how to handle it. And you've told the owners how the board and how the management company are going to handle that disaster. The one caveat to all this is if you do embark on an emergency preparedness plan, make sure that you can deliver on it. So if you're going to say, we're going to set up a communication center in the recreation center, make sure you have the capability to do that. And make sure you've got the legal authority to do whatever it is you're promising to do. Committees, there's only a handful of associations that I represent. Our firm collectively represents close to 900 associations in between all of our offices in three different states. I've heard about two or three that actually have a plan in place, which to me isn't a good thing. The ones that have, and the research that I've done, they've all utilized committees. If you're a condominium, the Condominium Act and the Nonprofit Corporation Act give you the authority to create as many committees as you want for any purpose. You can have a committee for a Labor Day barbecue. You have a committee for a newsletter. And you can have a committee to put together an emergency preparedness plan. And if you have owners that live in the building that have special skills, whether it's telecommunication skills, they're a ham radio licensee, they know first aid, utilize those people and those skills to put the plan in place. We'll talk more about plans in just a minute. Then the question is, well, do the committees have liability? And the answer should be, no, they don't. And the reason for that is committees only make recommendations. At least they should. I know that some associations set up committees that have decision-making authority. Some instances that may be okay, but generally speaking, a committee of the association or the board Their only authority is to make recommendations to the board. And then the board makes the decision to implement those. And the reason that's important, and we'll talk about insurance in a minute, is that your directors and officers liability policy, which is there to protect board members and the board from liability for making bad decisions, sometimes excludes committees. So if there's no coverage under your D&O policy, committee makes a decision, harms someone, they may be unprotected. That's why they should make the recommendations to the board should vote to implement those. We've got a few managers here, and a few things to keep in mind. If there is a disaster or an emergency, the board and every owner is going to look to the management company for hands-on attention. They do that now anyway, I'm assuming, right? When things happen that are unexpected, they look to the management company. They're the experts, they know how to deal with these kinds of things. In truth, do they? Well, generally yes, but there's a lot of things that just aren't contemplated by management companies. For example, natural disasters, earthquakes, primarily because they haven't had to go through that experience quite yet. But when it does happen, they're going to be expected to know how to handle it. It's going to require additional staff. Make sure that if it's going to, if you're going to end up spending 100 extra hours, you have something in the management contract to make sure you're compensated for that. Hopefully, you've got something like that if you work extra hours. And they'll be expected to act as a communication center because that's who owners know who to contact, especially if there's something that has went wrong and board members are unavailable. They're going to contact the management company. So, as a management company, be prepared for the consequences of a disaster. Let's talk about insurance. Insurance is probably the most important and yet most overlooked aspect of condominium operations and for landlords and tenants. The insurance issue, it's usually not contemplated because it's difficult to understand. But let's talk about some of the basics. You usually have a few different types of insurance. You have general liability. I slip and fall in the stairwell. I hurt my back. Your liability policy will kick in to deal with that. Property policy. Fire hits, burns four units and common elements. Your property policy is going to kick in and handle that. D&O or E&O, errors and omissions, or directors and officers, that's when you make a bad decision as a board, someone gets hurt by it. Let's say the board decides to hire XYZ company and the contract goes south, and owners end up having to pony up a special assessment. They get sued, directors and officers policy kicks in because it was a decision that was made that harmed someone economically, all right? For owners, if you're a condo owner, your policy is probably what's called an HO6 policy. If you're a tenant, then you have a standard renter's policy. For the owners or renters, let's talk about condominium policies first for owners. The way to view these is if you were to take your condominium unit, turn it upside down and shake it, anything that falls out is generally going to be covered by your HO6 policy. If it's not, then it's the property policy of the association. So the common elements, sometimes the floor, sometimes fixed structures, those will generally be covered by the property policy. The reason these are important to have, and most association governing documents require owners to carry their own insurance policy, is they cover things like hotel expenses, rental cars. If your car gets damaged, there's an earthquake, the parking garage collapses, and your car gets damaged and you can't drive it. Those types of out-of-pocket expenses are what are covered by your HO6 policy. The association's property policy doesn't cover that stuff. So if you don't have an HO6 policy, and your $50,000 grand piano got damaged by a flood, you're out of luck because the association's policy is not going to cover it. Yours was designed to cover it. If you don't have it, you're out of luck. Most insurance companies will do a relatively thorough, free analysis of your existing policy for the association board and the association's policies to say you've got enough coverage or you should consider this coverage. A lot of associations don't realize how cheap some of these additional riders are. For example, I gave a presentation about a year ago on embezzlement, and someone asked, well, is there insurance for it? And I said, yeah, there's what's called a fidelity policy or a fidelity rider. So I called the State Farm agent here that deals with condo policies, for $100,000 worth of coverage, it was $50 a year for that coverage. So management company or the treasurer of the association steals $100,000, it gets put back by the insurance company, and you've only paid $50 a year for that rider. So talk with your insurance agent. If you're a board, talk with the condo policy insurance company, and if you're an owner, certainly talk with your individual agent. Make sure that they've reviewed the association's governing documents to make sure that your insurance covers whatever the association's insurance policy doesn't cover. Now, if you've ever had to deal with an insurance company, you probably know that insurance companies understand exclusions. If you ever look at your policy, what's covered is about a page or two, and then you have 50 pages of what's excluded. Anyone in the insurance business? I hope not, so I'll probably say some offensive things about the insurance industry. So there's all of these exclusions. Some of the standard exclusions, and I'll come back to that in a sec, wind-driven rain. Rain's okay, but if it's wind-driven, not okay. Sewer backups, flood, earthquake, boiler explosions, usually not covered under the property policy. Water seepage. So let's say it's a slow leak from a pipe and it seeps over the course of a month, not covered. But you can get a lot of additional coverages, and usually for very cheap supplemental loss. So it is water seepage coverage. Almost every insurance policy, whether it's owner or association, has a mold exclusion. So if mold grows as a result of the water intrusion and you get sick because it's toxic mold, it's excluded from the policy. You can get additions, alterations, improvements, earthquake, flood. Bryce, just out of curiosity, do any of your associations in the Pearl have earthquake or flood insurance? Most of them. Cost-wise?
Most have earthquake, not flood.
Most have earthquake, but not flood. I'll repeat that. Bryce said that the price for earthquake coverage is getting very expensive. A lot of the additional coverages for natural disasters are getting expensive. But you got to consider, as a board, is it worth that extra expense? If you've got money in the general operating fund to cover additional earthquake coverage, it's probably worth doing it, especially if you don't have to end up increasing assessments of the owner. So which policies apply? I talked about that a minute ago. If you have a standard policy that excludes insurance, or excuse me, that excludes earthquake or flood, and one of those events happens, you're out of luck. You're what we call self-insured. You pay for it on your own through a special assessment. And in this economy, the associations that I've seen that have had to levy a special assessment, whether it's for construction defects or other things that they hadn't considered, most of the time, the bulk of the owners can't pay a big special assessment. So now you have a bunch of foreclosures and people walking away from their units. So a special assessment, if it's big, in this economy, isn't going to go over well. Now, in terms of plans, like I said, don't include things that the board can't actually deliver on. And this is going to be, when it comes to formulating these plans, the committees first, but you're going to have to deal with and include the management company in these plans. And here's why. It's the management companies that know the ins and outs of the HVAC system, the elevator system. They're the ones that have the institutional knowledge of your building. If it's a landlord issue, once again, make sure that you've got the resources to deliver on whatever that plan says. And we'll look at some of the things we need to contemplate when we're coming up with these plans. When it comes time to consider what the plan should include, I had one, and I was going to use it as a sample, but it's about 500 pages long. And the reason for that is it has step-by-step instructions for every component of the building, the boiler, the elevator. And so depending on what type of building you have, your plan is going to be different. So figure out what kind of structures there are. River Place Plan Community or condos down on the waterfront, they have all different types of structures. They've got wood frame condos, they have restaurants, and it's all part of the restaurant is part of the, am I right on this? Condominium. It's part of the, it's a condominium restaurant. You have no idea that it's a condominium, but if you go in and eat there, it's a condominium and it's part of that. And you've got to be able to contemplate how to deal with disasters that affect that condominium unit, which also happens to be a restaurant, which also happens to have very different types of equipment. The construction materials are also important to consider, and then the demographic. I represent a lot of associations in King City. The demographic down there is very, very different than the demographic in the Pearl. So consider that as well. HVAC, elevator, those components, if you've got highly technical components, Mr. Dorn, in the Avenue, I know they have a very odd, I don't want to say odd, but some kind of boiler system for their water. And it's complicated. So I remember looking at that issue years ago. Very complicated. I'm not sure that there's any other buildings that have that type of boiler system. There's does. Someone, somewhere needs to know how to deal with it should there be a problem. So there's two types of plans that you should think about. There's the emergency plan. What do we do as soon as disaster happens? And then there's the recovery side of it. Now the peril has happened. How do we deal with the aftermath? And typically, most associations that I've seen that have adopted plans have those plans as two separate plans. How to deal with evacuation, immediate communications, and then the day after, how do we deal with the cleanup and everything else that needs to happen to get the building back to normal, if it's capable of getting back to normal. So the plans, in terms of what to think about, and I'll talk more about this in a minute, how to account for residents, survey the property and the prioritization of what to fix first. You probably want to fix elevators first so people can get up and down. The hot water, the HVAC, there's going to be a prioritization of things to address that or look at first right after the disaster happens. Establishing communication and then an evacuation plan. I live in a high rise on the south waterfront. Two New Year's Eves ago, I was sound asleep, alarm went off. I didn't know where the stairwell was. It happened to be right across the hallway. I had no idea. The alarm went off in my unit. Loud noise, blinking light. I had no idea where to go or what to do. I walked out and followed some of my neighbors down the stairwell 14 floors until I got out. I had no idea. I never looked. I know now. In terms of the recovery plans, usually, if you're managed by a professional management company, they are the holders of records and information. Nevertheless, the board should have access to this information or copies of this information, your banking information. Your vendor contractor list is probably the most critical list that you need. Who takes care of the elevator? Who takes care of the HVAC? Those components. Have their information on a handy sheet. One of these handouts that I have is a contact sheet so that everyone on the board, and if board members leave and new board members get on, that list can be passed around, so that everyone on the board has a list of who to call first to deal with particular components of the building. Owner and resident list, an equipment inventory, contingency plans. In terms of the records, this is just a sample of the records. Some associations, American Plaza, for example, in downtown, they've been around since the 70s. They have, I don't know how many hundreds of linear feet of records. Nowadays, a lot of those are digitized. There are a ton of records, a lot of them important. If it's an older association, oftentimes those records are buried somewhere and no one knows where to get it or how to access it. But these are the records you should think about having, probably in a digital form that's easy to access. But the as-built facility plans, usually the management company has those plans, structural plans, HVAC plans. A list of the board, the committees, and again, this is on one of your handouts. The vendor list, like I said, is the most important. The other handout is a sample community association emergency procedures. And this has the space to put, hopefully, every contractor or vendor that you're going to need to deal with in your building. And that is the sheet that everyone should circulate among the board and make sure that new board members get and that the management company has. Let's look for a minute at the plan consideration. So this outline here is a very good starting point for a committee or a board in formulating a plan. And you can do each one of these for each different type of peril. When I say peril, I mean an event that causes damage, earthquake, flood, fire, sewer backup. And so my recommendation is to have a sheet like this for each type of peril. You can consolidate those into one document. But it goes through and says, what's the peril or disaster that you're planning for? Talk about the likelihood of the occurrence. Do you live on a fault line? Do you live in a floodplain? Is there a restaurant below that could have a kitchen fire that could go up? And then figure out the planning part of it. Which insurance policy is going to get tapped for that particular type of disaster? What's the deductible? If you turn the page, it talks about, well, who's responsible for the deductible. In condo associations, of course, you can assign the deductible to owners if they're the cause of the event. If it's the owner who left their stove on and caused the fire, it's still going to be the association's policy that's going to cover the damage to the common elements, but you can make that owner pay that deductible. Just out of curiosity, what are most of the deductibles for your property policies, Bryce?
$10,000.
Okay, I'll repeat that. So for property policies, the deductible is often $10,000. For earthquake coverage, 2-5% of whatever the total loss is. And keep in mind, there's probably a section in your declaration that talks about damage or destruction and how to handle whether or not to rebuild. Most documents, if there's substantial damage or destruction, may require a vote of the owners to say, yes, we're going to rebuild this and live here again. Or no, we're going to move on, and this is a total disaster, and it's not worth it economically. Maybe because the insurance deductible is too high, or they didn't have earthquake coverage or flood coverage. So most of the time, there's going to be a vote of owners to deal with what to do next if there's bad, substantial damage. All right, communication planning. The communication piece is important. On 9/11, my little sister lived in New York. She was on her way into the city for her birthday, which is 9/11. We couldn't get a hold of her on a cell phone for about 6 hours. Cell phone towers go down. I've started studying to be a ham radio operator because ham radios happen to be one form of communication that doesn't go down in natural disasters because there's so many repeaters. But consider how you're going to communicate with people. The management company. If phones go down, how do you get a hold of the management company? Bryce, you should probably give your home address out to most of the owners so they can come to your door if something happens. But
I already have.
Contemplate how you're going to get a hold of people, whether it's board members, managers, owners, to make sure they're okay. Again, I talked about consider your demographic. Next to my building is a condominium. It's a retirement condominium with varying levels of care, all the way from no care at all to 24/7. A lot of elderly people. How do you deal with people who can't get in and out of the building quickly or require a wheelchair? And the elevators are now down. What do you do? In terms of preparation, like I said, ideally you're going to have a committee that's going to come to the board with a proposed plan that the board's going to adopt. This is going to have some questions in here that you need to ask of the committee and of that proposed plan to make sure that it's proper. Notices, there's a section in here about sort of what are often referred to, the Red Cross started calling them 72-hour kits. The bag that you grab on your way out the door when there's something happening that allows you to survive for 72 hours. And this has the components that should go in there. And then the last piece is your insurance review, to talk with your insurance agent to make sure that you've got insurance to cover those disasters. That's the bulk of my presentation. I've reserved a fair amount of time for questions. You can ask me questions about anything that I've talked about tonight or anything that I have that relate to this, and I'm happy to answer. Yes?
So what we're going to do for a moment is Jan's going to come around and collect question cards. We're going to go ahead and hand them over. In the meantime, I did want to mention we have some folks here from the Elliott, and I just want to let you know they have done some pretty incredible planning, and they've really taken this seriously. Their plan is really technical, and although it'd be difficult and probably not very useful to share it in a large group setting like this, they have offered and are willing to communicate with another HOA board and talk through plans and see how they can improve theirs and talk about just comparing notes and improving. That said, they've taken steps. They're actually in the practicing phase. They're really doing some great work. So, Mr. Ryder is here up front. If you want to come and talk to him afterwards and maybe see about pairing up and comparing notes, it'd be great. So, in the meantime, Jim, do you have card talking?
Just out of curiosity, Elliot, how did this come about? Was there a board member or an owner who said this is a good idea, or was it the management company? How did it get spurred? I'm going to give you the mic so everyone can hear.
My name is Walt Wiley. This is Bob Wright. We're both residents. Now, this emergency plan that has been described here is really held by our engineering organization. It's called PREM, or MERP is the organization. And Mark Flosted is the head of that. And they really retain the responsibility for the emergency plan. But through the many contacts we've had with city emergency planning, we've been admonished that we might be alone. That if there's a serious earthquake, we may not be able to get hold of Mark and his organization. We may not be able to get hold of the fire department. So six of us in the organization, mostly with engineering backgrounds, have developed plans and have learned how to operate the mechanical systems in the building. Doesn't have to do with evacuation or medical. It's just the facilities, like the air conditioning system, the electrical system, the sprinkler system, who would turn it off in the event that it was jarred and started pouring water out and yet there was no fire. We learned to do that.
Gas as well.
Gas goes first, thank you. We want to shut down the elevators because we don't want people to get stuck in the elevator in an aftershock. We formed a committee, we wrote our plans. They're fairly brief, they're held in a book like this, and we are beginning practicing them. Before we completed, we went to the board, and Vial Fotheringham properly gave the board the appropriate motion to pass to authorize this committee to do this work. I want to repeat that this is a group of volunteers, and our function is if we can't get hold of the engineering organization and we can't get hold of the fire department, we know how to take the mechanical actions to make sure that life and property is protected. I think that answers your question.
Excellent. And a lot of the questions that I received deal with liability, about whether or not we'll get sued if we create one of these plans, and I'll address these in turn here. One thing to talk about, though, is you don't really have a duty to go and help someone. You're a fiduciary, but you don't have to go out of your way to help someone. But if you decide to help them and they get injured as a result, now you've got liability. California, for example, has a Good Samaritan law where if you help someone and you kill them by giving them CPR incorrectly, no liability. But if you ever saw the Seinfeld episode, the final episode, there was no Good Samaritan law. Jerry went to prison. No one remembers this? Okay, good. So my point is, plans should be broad enough that you can deal with the components and the emergencies like this gentleman just discussed, but without giving specific advice to owners about what they should and shouldn't do. Because once you go down that road, then you do open yourself up to potential liability. One of your other questions was, well, if we create our own plan without using information from other sources like FEMA or the Red Cross, is there a liability? Or if we footnote those in our plan and say we're referring to this, does that reduce our liability? Yes and no. You can footnote and refer to sources all you want, but if they're wrong, or wrong for your building, then it doesn't do you any good that you've relied on the Red Cross information in your plan. Who did you use, as a starting point, any other plans, Red Cross information, started it from scratch? Ideally, because condominium buildings, especially in the Pearl, are so unique, you've got Avenue, which is an older building that was converted into condos. Elliott is relatively brand new construction with completely different components. All of those buildings are so different that you're probably going to want to start from scratch to address the individual uniqueness of your building. One of the other questions was, well, if we have floor captains, there's a liability for floor captains. So let's say there's an emergency, floor captain makes a bad decision. That goes back to the committees. Board has appointed someone to do something on their behalf. If it's a floor captain, they've got some discretion, or they're going to have some discretion because it's a necessity, because there's an emergency. Check your insurance policy. Most policies do cover committees and do cover volunteer work on behalf of the association, depending on where it is. make sure your insurance coverage is broad enough that it would cover a floor captain in the event of an emergency. Now, let's say the floor captain makes a bad decision, gets sued. What's the outcome going to be in Multnomah County because a floor captain who was trying to do their best to get someone evacuated kicked someone on accident, hurt them? Is there going to be liability? Probably not. Can we still get sued? Yeah, like I said before, anyone can get sued for anything. It's the defense piece of it, which is why it's critical to make sure your insurance policy covers that, because at least the defense costs are going to be covered. Make sure that's there. I think I've addressed all of these. Oh, there's one on earthquake coverage. Bryce talked about that a little bit. Discuss earthquake insurance, pros, cons, amount of coverage. Again, as Bryce mentioned, it's getting more expensive. It's going to be a percentage of whatever the total reconstruction costs are. Talk with your insurance agent and see what that coverage is going to be. Even though it's expensive, most of your associations have it, correct? Okay, so some carry a few million, some carry half the value, some carry the full value. It's all going to depend on how much money you've got in general operating fund. Is there a question? Somewhere over here?
I think there was one question for having to do with renters.
With renters, oh yes. So difference between renter's policy and a condo owner's policy, what's covered and what's not. Hang on, I saw that somewhere. Oh, additional considerations for renters. What does renter's insurance cover? So unlike a HO6 condo owner policy, which is going to cover usually a little more than personal property, it could cover your hardwood flooring that you paid $10,000 to put in. Your renter's policy almost always is just going to cover personal property, stuff that you can pick up and move out, your stereo, your computer. It will also sometimes cover liability. So you've got a friend over at your apartment unit, they slip and fall, hurt themselves. It's your renter's policy that's going to cover that. If the accident or the slip and fall occurred on the stairwell up to your unit, then the landlord's liability policy would cover that. But it's the second they step into your unit and it's an issue caused by the renter, it's your renter's policy that will cover that as well. Same thing goes for those out-of-pocket economic expenses. There's a flood at the apartment complex. You as a renter have to move out. It's going to be a renter's policy that pays your hotel bill and your food bill. So not the landlord's property policy, your individual renter's policy. And renter's policies are super cheap for the most part. No reason not to have one. Some governing documents, if you're a condo owner and you're renting, have a provision that the renter of the condo unit has a renter's policy in addition to the owner's HO6 policy, in addition to the association's property policy. So look at those governing documents. But if you're a renter, renter's policy is so cheap that it's ridiculous not to have one. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Two questions. One is, have you seen, or do you have some ideas on how to get owners involved and maintain their fears and enthusiasm? And two, like so many things, plans to get together and initially get implemented, but how do you keep it
keep
online?
It going?
20
years. Yeah. I'll repeat those questions. The first one is, how do you get owners interested in coming up with a plan or being on a committee to create the plan? And then two, once you have the plan, how do you make sure that people are aware of it and that you're practicing the policies over the course of 5-20 years? In terms of owner interest, I always tell boards that if you want to get people out to a meeting to discuss anything, on the top of the notice, you put that you're going to raise assessments by $1,000 a month. And then when they get there, you say, joke's on you, thanks for coming, we have some serious issues to discuss.
Here's some food.
But honestly, this comes up a lot. How do you get people interested in anything in a condominium? There's usually a lot of apathy until something bad happens. Special assessment, rise in assessments, some big change. And I've asked other attorneys that do what I do, other people in my office, and 9 times out of 10, it is something social. food. I'm not kidding. Otherwise, you'd have to identify those owners who have that specialized knowledge and interest to do that. Sometimes it's a survey or a questionnaire. Sometimes it's something in the newsletter that says we're in the process of doing this. And the people that care about it and know about it, with this type of stuff, the emergency preparedness and disasters, they'll usually step up because they know that they've got specialized knowledge. But otherwise, it's a matter of knocking on doors to get people out. Can't do anything to force owners to get involved in anything. Sometimes that's a good thing. In this case, it's a bad thing. Once you've got the plan in place, it's the same thing with board resolutions. Most of the associations you might have, some of the old ones have 50 resolutions. You get a new board member, they may know about two or three of them, but no one knows what all of those resolutions are. They're not recorded in the county documents, so when you bought your unit, you didn't get them. You got your declaration and your bylaws. Those are the only two recorded documents. You don't get all the resolutions, you don't get your house rules, you don't get any of that stuff. Typically the management company gives it to you. Almost all of them do, but it's not recorded, so you don't get it at the time of closing. So my recommendation is always to boards, have a master notebook that goes between board chair to board chair to board chair that has everything in it, especially the stuff that's not recorded, so that there is that institutional knowledge that gets passed down and passed down. Sometimes the management company keeps all that stuff. Now that's great, but it's a board member or a board chair that should have that information so that if they switch management companies or a disaster strikes and the management company office is inaccessible, they've got that information. It sounds like this book you put together, does each board member have one of those books?
They have read it.
They have read it, okay. Down the road, is each board member going to get it, or will there be one book that's passed?
No, they're not authorized to take any action, so they've been shown the book, but they don't receive the book.
Gotcha. Board members or committee members?
Committee members all have books. Board members have seen them.
Okay.
But they don't have their own copy.
Has the board signed off on the plan?
Yes.
Okay, so they've essentially granted the authority to deal with this to the committee.
Yes.
And that's perfectly fair. The board has essentially made a decision that they're granting authority to act when it comes to these issues to the committee. Perfectly fine. Again, make sure committee members are covered under the DNA policy. I suspect yours is.
Well, your firm wrote the motion.
My firm wrote, then I'm sure it's bulletproof, 100% correct. Yes, ma'am.
How much responsibility does the board have to make sure that owners continue to maintain the insurance and
improve? Excellent question. I didn't hear the last part. The first part is, how much responsibility does the board have to make sure that owners are carrying their own HO6 or individual owner's policy? What was the second part?
And that includes
earthquake insurance. Well, the individual owner, the HO6 policy, owners generally aren't going to be able to get earthquake coverage. It's going to be the condominium association that has that obligation to get earthquake coverage. So because your ownership interest is your finished surface in, not the structure itself, you're, as an owner, probably not going to get earthquake coverage, the association price. Yeah, you can get a right. You're right. So if there's an
earthquake.
Okay, I'll repeat that. So as an individual owner, you can get a rider. It's often called a special assessment rider. So that earthquake happens, let's say 3 of 100 units are damaged. Yours is one of them. Special assessment among all the owners. That rider would pay your share of the special assessment that may fix a portion of your unit. But the policy for the typical earthquake policy for the structure itself is going to be something that will be in the association's name.
But does the board have to make sure that people are carrying that insurance?
Excellent question. So like I said, the question was, does the board have to make sure that owners have that? Most declarations or CCNRs have a requirement that owners carry their own policy. Well, what's the board's obligation to go out and make sure that that's happening? They have an obligation. They have an obligation to once a month make sure that they submit that each owner submit their policy statement or proof of insurance. Probably not. Most associations that I'm aware of, do you guys do a check at all? Most associations don't actually check, and it only comes up when something happens, and then they find out the owner doesn't have it. It's too laborious. It's tedious. Every owner would have to be submitting their policy statements probably annually to verify that. Yeah, people switch their HO6 policy frequently. So most associations don't monitor that. I've given that advice, and I'll repeat what Bryce said. Bryce said, if you go down the road of telling owners that the association is going to monitor insurance coverage, and they miss it, new board comes in, and they didn't monitor the coverage, something happens, there's no coverage. Now, as the board opened themselves up, because they've taken it upon themselves to monitor that, possible liability. So the short answer is, the CCNRs tell the association, the declaration tells the association and owners what they have to do, what they can and cannot do. When the owner buys in, they're legally obligated to have that. I don't think the board is legally obligated to make sure that they're doing that. Can you do it? Do you have the authority? Probably. But it's probably not an efficient thing to do. And every owner, and the reason I say it's probably not a huge deal to monitor that is because if something does happen, HO6 policy isn't there, it's going to come out of the owner's pocket to replace his or her goods or property that would have been covered by the HO6 policy. The association isn't going to have an obligation to replace the stereo that was lost in the flood just because the owner didn't have a policy. So ultimately, it only hurts the owner. The association probably isn't going to be harmed by an owner's lack of an individual policy. I'm sure there's a lot of hypotheticals I could think of where that might not be the case, but generally speaking, that's the case.
We are in the process of developing our emergency plan. And so obviously there's a lot of discussions as to what we will or will not do. So is it then important that at some point that the board is going to be ratifying that plan, and that's when kind of a liability So before that happens, we may say, well, in case of an earthquake, we will do this, that, and the other, but we will not be able to deliver at this point. We will not be incurring liability.
Okay, excellent question. I'll repeat it. So her question was, we're starting down the road of creating a plan. Once the board says, yes, we accept the plan, then do you open yourselves up to liability? Probably not. And I'll go back to this liability discussion, which was, is there a duty to come up with an emergency preparedness plan? Probably not. If you do and you do it incorrectly, do you open yourself up? Yes. So I think you're better off in terms of liability to come up with a good plan that addresses primarily the common elements and how to deal with those, and not telling owners that they need to go left on floor 14 and telling them exactly what to do, giving general instructions though. I think you're less open to legal liability than doing nothing at all. So once the board says, yes, this is our plan, if it's a properly drafted plan, I think you are in a better legal position than you were without a plan at all.
But as we are developing the plan, we kind of are we better in a position as at least we are trying, or in terms of, well, we don't have a plan yet? I mean, it's kind of in a limbo.
Yeah. Here's what I often tell board members. When boards get sued, the general thought process of the court is, these are volunteer people serving on the board with no pay. Did they do their best? And if the answer to that is yes, then my answer is usually, you're not going to be found liable. If you're a volunteer board member, you've got statutory protections against you from liability. And as long as you're doing your best and not making decisions that you know are going to harm someone, you're going to be okay. You might get sued. It happens all the time. That's why you have insurance to pay those defense costs. But generally, if you're doing your best and you're creating a plan and you're coming up with ideas, I think you're fine.
Well,
the question was, earthquake happens, you shouldn't use the sewer, you shouldn't use the sewer system because it could create a community problem with sewer overflow and that kind of thing. Let me rephrase what I said about the floor captains, which I tried to say was, in the event of emergency, the floor captains are going to be telling people what to do and where to go. And as long as they're doing their best, I think there's no liability. So when the disaster happens, yeah, they're in a position where they are going to be telling people what to do and not to do. If it's a decision that the board contemplates and offers a rationale in the plan about why they shouldn't use the sewer, I think it's fine. In Oregon and a lot of other jurisdictions, there's what's called the business judgment rule, which says if a board makes a decision, even a bad decision, if they've contemplated it, they've deliberated about it, they sought expert advice, and then made their decision, and it turns out to be a bad decision, there's no liability because of the business judgment rule. So that's why I tell boards, when you create a resolution for anything, put in your authority to do it, why you're doing it, who you consulted with to make sure it was okay, and then the resolution itself. But have that information so that when owners see it, they know why you're doing it, what your authority is, and how you came to the decision. That's why Oregon has an open meetings requirement for board members, or for boards, meetings. Owners are entitled to sit there and watch you as a board member come to the decisions that you come to. Deliberate, think about it, get expert advice, you're gonna be okay. No, actually, I'm not. Her question was, am I familiar with the Oregon Good Samaritan law? No, but if you are, I'd love to hear it.
What I've read is that it only applies to professionals. So if you're an EMT, you're a doctor, you're a nurse, it applies to you, but one of our residents is a retired doctor, it does not apply to
them. And I'll repeat that. So the Oregon Good Samaritan law applies to professionals. So say you're an ER doctor and you're out for a jog, you help someone, then it applies. If you're a retired or non-practicing professional, you do the same thing, does not apply. And I'll tell you right now, I don't know the ins and outs of that, but
that's
interesting.
People should look at.
Yeah.
There is a way to get around it through Red Cross certification.
Interesting.
But if you are looking at that as an issue, it's clearly not a straightforward thing.
Good point, yes. Gist of that was, it's not a straightforward point, the Good Samaritan law in Oregon.
Yeah, it's in the vehicle code also.
It's in what, the vehicle code?
State of Oregon. See someone in distress, you are, if you hold a license, you are expected to.
Oh, so if you're a licensed medical professional, you are obligated?
Just an individual.
Oh, individual.
Which really surprised me.
Yeah, good point. Other questions? Yes.
What can an individual do when they, well, I'll just give you the example. I recently applied to renew my renter's insurance policy. I've always carried earthquake insurance along with the renter's policy. And when I recently moved, the insurance company removed the earthquake coverage because they said I was living in an unreinforced masonry building or an MR. And the fact is, I'm not. I've seen these from our manager. I've seen the structural document that specifically states it is a reinforced masonry building, but I can't get anywhere with the insurance company because they say their information comes from city records.
Okay, I'll repeat this. Her last apartment she rented, she had an earthquake rider, moved to a new building. They refused to give the earthquake rider because they said it wasn't structurally adequate, and that was based on city records. Two things. One, insurance companies always say no for everything, whether it's a claim, whether it's for whatever. If there is information that you have that says you're wrong, send it to them. Usually a response from the insurance policy holder with accurate, substantial information, they'll change their mind, oftentimes. The other thing is there are hundreds of insurance companies out there, and you'll probably find them one that will. I always get boards to say, well, we've had three or four claims on our D&O policy. If we tender this one, they're going to drop us. I say, so what? There's 100 other companies out there. You might pay an extra $1,000 a year, but you can get coverage, and you're better off tendering this to your carrier for defense costs because you might end up paying $100,000 in defense costs rather than $1,000 for a new policy from a different insurance company. So, point is, shop around. There may be another insurance company that has that. Those insurance companies, I don't know what, when they say city records, if they've got their own repository that may be wrong or outdated, but certainly in writing, put something in writing that says you're wrong, and here's the information to substantiate that. And if they still say no, shop around. Pretty sure you'll find someone out there who's insured. Yes, ma'am? Yeah, when you send it certified. Someone's dealt with insurance companies before. Oh, you worked for one. Oh, boy. No, they're not all bad. Yes?
May I be specific on the question of floor cap?
Yeah.
What I was referring to is, if you will, a network of communicators. Those on the floor who know who lives on the floor, who needs special attention.
Gotcha.
Who's renting, who owns, who's moving in and out, but they pretty much track.
Gotcha. As opposed to taking charge in an emergency.
Not a police function.
Gotcha.
But I recall the first meeting that Jan and Bill held, the fire and rescue people said they liked the idea of there being a warden system, communication system, so when they come into the building, somebody knows, yes, the fire is on the third floor in the east building. And that's what my point is, but in having volunteers to set up this communication network, and they're identified, they're listed, my name's on it, is the board then liable if something happens to me or that I do something inadvertently?
I don't think so. And a couple of things. One, when you put this plan in place for issues like that, I would be very clear in the language, in bold print, that floor captains or other certain volunteers, they're volunteers. There's no legal obligation for them to do anything. They're doing it as a civil or a civic service, so to speak, for their neighbors. One thing about, and what this gentleman corrected me on was when he was talking about floor captains, someone that's sort of a repository of information for people on that floor. Just be very aware of privacy issues. You may have that owner that doesn't want anyone to know anything about them. And when the legislature implemented the electronic communication notices and stuff that could go by email, every board was ready to jump on and ask everyone for their email addresses, but the statute specifically says owners can opt out. If an owner doesn't want to give their email address or other personal information to anyone, they don't really have to. There is some information that they're legally obligated to tell them, but most of the time, email, cell phone numbers, there's no obligation for me as an owner to give that to anybody. So, if ideally, most owners are probably going to be open to the idea of giving that information to someone on their floor that they know that's going to be used to for contact or communications for emergency reasons, and I don't see any problem with that. I think I'm almost out of time now, or I am out of time, probably.
Yeah, we're gonna go ahead and wrap up. Take a moment to think.
I think I brought enough handouts. If not, you can email me and I'll send it to you. I also will email you this presentation in PDF or whatever format if anyone wants any other information. What's that? Yeah, I can just PDF that and send it to anyone that asks for it. So there's my contact info. Thank you.
All right, so many of you came, I saw in groups. And you might happen to be the one person that came in and there isn't anybody else from your building here. If that's the case, remember, it usually only takes one person in the building to get something like this going. You mentioned the question about how to get interest. Build awareness, you know. Ask your management company or HOA if you can post notices. That's one of the things that we did in our building. I do have a list of, we called it our awareness campaign. And it worked, it was pretty effective. That said, it's always going to come back to rallying the troops each year and having a plan that's sustainable. The other thing I think we all should walk away with is that we should include professionals in our plan. We didn't have an insurance representative here tonight, but I would imagine that everybody in here or that has an HOA building or is in an HOA or condominium has somebody that wrote a master policy. You can also pull your insurance agents into this process, ask their advice, and make sure they're part of the plan. You know, before we finished up, I wanted to just one more time thank the Pearl District Neighborhood Livability Committee. I get up here at these different events mainly because I lost a coin toss and was forced to. No, I'm kidding. I didn't. That said, the Livability Committee does so much for our neighborhood beyond emergency preparedness. If you want to join, talk to Jan Valentine. She's right here in the aisle. And also, if you want to get your building more involved, please talk to Jan. It would be great to tie as many of us together as possible. Once again, just wanted to go back through kind of some of the things we've been talking about in this series is start on an individual level, get your emergency kit, get the supplies you need for water and sanitation. We had the speakers last time. You can go to Office Max, the Cole kind of handbook on sanitation issues. Feel free to ask me questions after if you have any about that. And always include the professionals in this planning process. So thank you so much for coming, and have a nice evening.